Welcome to our Wednesday night Lenten service. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio.
Good evening. And welcome to our midweek Lenten service for this evening. As we have been doing, we will be using the prayer service of suffrages beginning on page 348. In the front of your worship book, but we begin this evening by singing hymn number 338, Beneath the Cross of Jesus, hymn number 338 in the back of your worship.
Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Show us your mercy, O God.
And grant us your salvation.
Give us the joy of your saving help again.
And sustain us with your bountiful spirit.
Give peace in all the world.
For only you can live in safety.
Keep the nations under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving help among all nations.
Let not the needy be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in me a clean heart, O God.
And sustain me with your Holy Spirit.
Lord, hear my prayer.
And let my cry come before you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously protected us today. We ask you to forgive us all our sins where we have been wrong, and graciously to protect us tonight. Into your hands we commend ourselves, our bodies, our souls, and all that is ours. Let your holy angels be with us, so that the wicked foe may have no power over us. Amen. After an initial interview, Pilate sends him to Herod, since he is supposedly from Nazareth. Herod, being disappointed that Jesus will do nothing spectacular for him, sends him back to Pilate. Pilate has a short interview with Jesus before going out to the judgment seat and preparing to once again honor a Passover custom that had been happening each Passover, where Pilate would ask the people for which prisoner they would like released, since it had been established that on that day one prisoner would be released. But before Pilate can offer them the choice, Pilate's wife sends him a message. And as we read in our gospel lesson this evening, besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream. Now, Pilate faces a dilemma. Does he listen to his wife, or does he give it to the crowd? Does he listen to his wife and actually proclaim Roman justice? The law of Rome, which said no innocent man could ever be put to death. Will Pilate fulfill that duty as one who was sworn to uphold the laws of Rome? Or will he listen to the crowd? As we know, he listens to the crowd. Which brings us then to ask, who was Pilate's wife? Out of the four Gospels and their accounts of the crucifixion, Matthew is the only one who mentions Pilate's wife. As the years went by, there began more and more information circulating in the church about Pilate's wife. Over the years, she was given the name Procula, and in other writings, the name Claudia, and in others, Claudia Procula. She is mentioned in many of what we call the apocryphal New Testament writings. What these are writings that either no copy of them has been found dating to the first century, or they are writings which are never mentioned by the earliest church fathers. I'm not talking about Jerome, I'm not talking about Gregory the Great, I'm not talking about St. John Chrysostom or St. Augustine, I'm not talking about Tertullian or Origen, who got later. I'm talking about people like Clement of Rome, who ascended to the hierarchy of the church within the first 50 or so years of the church, and lived out the latter part of the first century, and some even into the beginning of the second century. This is how we came up with the books in our New Testament. These were all mentioned by those early church fathers and accepted as legitimate. But in these apocryphal books, we have such as the Gospel of Barnabas, the Gospel of Thomas, the Acts of Pontius Pilate. We have this tradition that Pilate's wife, Procula, Claudia Procula, became a Christian. And that this dream was part of what brought her to the Christian faith. She is so highly thought of in the Eastern world of Christianity that the Eastern Orthodox Church and the Ethiopian Orthodox Church both claim her to be a saint, Saint Claudia Procula. Each of them having a feast day, though a different feast day, in their church calendar to celebrate her witness to the Christian faith. There is even some tradition that Pilate later becomes a Christian as well, that they both were martyred for the Christian faith in Rome under the man emperor Nero. So, Claudia has this dream, telling Pilate they have nothing to do with Jesus. Another question arises. Was the dream sent by God, or was the dream sent by Satan? Was the dream sent by God, as Origen says, a 3rd century Christian writer, he says that the dream was sent by God so that she would become a Christian, and that because of the dream she became a Christian. Others claim that the dream led her to becoming a Christian. They say the dream came from God. And it was similar to other dreams we read in the Gospel of Matthew, where God's will is spelled out in a dream. Others, though, there is a dissenting view, which say that the dream was sent by Satan. Their argument is that had Pilate listened to his wife, had he proclaimed the true Roman justice, which said an innocent man could not die, if he had freed Jesus, God's plan of salvation would have been disrupted and derailed. How does Jesus die for the sins of the world if Pilate sets him free? How do we have salvation if the only innocent man does not die for us and pay the debt of sin that we owe? And so old scholars say it came from Satan, trying to get Procula basically to be the new Eve, to convince her husband into that which was against God's will. The majority think the dream was sent by God. And I think, and I agree with those who say it was sent by God, because in this dream, not only is she expressing her feelings and what she is going through, but she is foreshadowing the life of the church. She is foreshadowing the life of the Christian. She is foreshadowing how the world will treat Jesus Christ. Have nothing to do with him. That phrase literally means to have no account with someone. Like, don't do business with them, don't have fellowship with them, don't do anything with them. It means not at all. So absolutely not at all have anything to do with this man. Or it means no matter what. In other words, no matter what happens, no matter if the sun falls out of the sky, no matter if the earth stands still, do not let this innocent man be condemned to death. That is what she is saying. The wife's request was asking for freedom for Christ. But today, the world looks at her words, have nothing to do with him, and me, and take it to have no account with him, no association with him, to no matter what, don't become a Christian. And we see the world today more and more wanting to push Jesus totally out of our society. Some of you may have seen the article about the humanist, some humanist group that is suing the VFW in Maryland, not far from the Arlington Cemetery in Virginia. And they're suing the VFW for this monument they have to the veterans of World War II. And it happens to be in the shape of a cross. And they are saying it violates the First Amendment, the establishment clause, which it does no such thing. The First Amendment simply says the federal government cannot establish a religion. It doesn't say that religion cannot be freely practiced in its cities, counties, and towns. And the writer goes on to say the scary thing about this case is that if they would rule that the VFW would have to take that cross down, their next target is Arlington Cemetery. That Arlington Cemetery would have to take all of its crosses down because it's, quote, promoting Christianity. I've been to Arlington to the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, but I didn't go through the whole cemetery to see the different graves. But if it's like what I've seen in the pictures of the graves in Normandy, and what my dad told me when he and Mom went to Normandy to retrace where he was during World War II and went through the cemetery, there was a cross only in the graves of those who were Christians. If a soldier died in Normandy or Europe and was buried in that cemetery and he's Jewish, there's a Star of David on his tombstone. And if, I don't know how many Muslims or Buddhists or Hindus would have been in the American army in 1945 or 1944, but if there are any of those, their religion is what the symbol is. It's not a cross. So the humans have a failed argument. But that is what society is trying to do today. It's trying to kick Jesus totally out of the public life, totally out of the public sector. Have nothing to do with this man, procular men, free. Society takes it today to mean kick Christianity out of it. Of course, they always fall back on that worn out phrase, separation of church and state, which is a total taking out of context what Thomas Jefferson said when he meant that, wrote that statement. First of all, Thomas Jefferson was not at the Constitutional Convention. Thomas Jefferson was in France, dealing America's business with France. He did not write any of the Constitution. George Mason, which George Mason University in Virginia is named, is the father of the Bill of Rights. And he wrote the First Amendment with the help of Madison. And that was the least of their thoughts, that the First Amendment would kick Christianity out of public life altogether. Jefferson is writing years after the Constitution, as the third president of the United States, writing to a group of Baptists in Connecticut. These Baptists write the president because they're afraid Connecticut is going to make them become Episcopalians. And if you know your history, you know the Episcopalians are the American Anglicans, the Church of England. But of course, after the Revolutionary War, they couldn't call themselves the Church of England anymore, or Anglicans, because the head of the Anglican Church is the King or Queen of England, who's ever reigning at the time. So they took on the name Episcopalians. And since the Revolution, the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church in America does go to the Worldwide Anglican Conference of Bishops when they have it. But anyhow, back to the story. These Baptists feared they were going to be forced to become Episcopalians. So they write President Jefferson. And Jefferson sends them a letter back. And in this letter he says, you have nothing to fear because there has been this great wall of separation between church and state to protect you, to protect the church from the state. Jefferson wasn't talking about protecting the state from the church. He was talking about the church being protected from the state. So that in America, you cannot have what happens in Europe, where a leader comes into power and he tries or can't try if there's a state church to dictate what that church will do. Have nothing to do with that man. Does not mean kick Christianity out. It means free Jesus. And so many today want to be free from Christ instead of being free in Christ. Instead of being free from sin, death, and the power of the devil, they would rather chase the trinkets of this physical, mortal world than think about the glory of eternity in the eternal kingdom of God. And so, Procula, St. Claudia Procula, whatever her name might have been, because as I said, other writings give her a different name. Whatever her name, she was talking about freedom in Christ, not from Christ. Then she says, he is a righteous man. That word righteous means to be holy, to be innocent, or to be just. Jesus was holy, Jesus was innocent, and Jesus was just. But he did not receive justice from Pilate. Pilate caves in to the crowd. Pilate is intimidated when the high priest and his cronies say that he will not be Caesar's friend if he releases Jesus. He becomes intimidated by the crowd when they say, we have no king but Caesar. Although their actions have been totally lacking in that respect. He knows Jesus is innocent. As we read in our gospel lesson, before his wife sends to him the message about her dream, he says in verse 18, for he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. That shows Pilate that he was innocent. But again, we are talking about God's plan of salvation. And God's plan of salvation required that the innocent Son of God had to die on the cross so that his blood would be the sacrifice to pay the debt of the sins of all the world. That his sacrifice would be the final sacrifice. As I mentioned some weeks ago, I believe it was a Sunday morning sermon. This is what John the Baptist meant when he saw Jesus walking along the seashore. And he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. At Passover, a lamb was sacrificed. Jesus was the final true lamb. So, to make that sacrifice, he had to be innocent, he had to be holy, he had to be just, and the wife of Pilate is confirming that. Her dream confirms that Jesus is that innocent sacrifice that will satisfy the wrath of God. And then she says, I have suffered much because of him today in a dream. The word suffer means to experience evil or to experience pain. So in this dream, she experiences pain because she knows an innocent man is going to be condemned. She suffers evil in that she sees the evil in the actions of her husband if he condemns Jesus to death. But at this point, she does not realize it's God's plan of salvation. At this point, she does not realize that her husband is simply doing what must be necessary so that we can be the children of God. So that we can be children of the Heavenly Father. So that we are not sinners in the hands of an angry God. Experienced pain, and they have experienced evil. I'm not talking about physical pain or suffering brought on by disease or sickness or injury. We're talking about spiritual pain and suffering, or we're talking about physical pain and suffering brought about by our oppression and persecution. In the 7th chapter of Acts, we read of the first martyr of the church, Saint Stephen. A few chapters later, we read of the second known martyr of the church, or at least it's listed in the book of Acts. I'm sure there were probably more before him, and probably even before Stephen. These are the first two we know about. The second is James, the brother of John. Herod Agrippa, king of Galilee, has James executed. And when he sees how much it pleases the Jews, he has St. Peter arrested so that he can execute him and win even more favor. But if you're familiar with the story in the book of Acts, you know that in the night God sent an angel of the Lord who freed St. Peter from his chains, opened up the prison doors, and allowed Peter to go to the house of John Mark. He knocks on the door, the servant answers, can't believe it's Peter, and closes the door in his face. She goes to those who are in the house and tells them, it's Peter outside, I think, or it's his ghost. So they go back and they all open the door together in strength and numbers. It's the ghost, we're all here together. You know, it's really Peter, we can all celebrate. And of course, it's really Peter. And Peter comes in and they pray and sing praises to God for the deliverance of Peter and Herod Agrippa, whose plan is failed. But there are others then, there are thousands, millions, billions of Christians who've been martyred for the Christian faith. As we gather together tonight in safety to worship our Lord, there are Christians all over the world being oppressed, persecuted, and executed. In China, in North Korea, in Pakistan, in other Middle Eastern countries, Christians are still martyred for being a Christian. We know of the brutality of ISIS in Syria and Iraq, but there's other countries that oppress and execute Christians, especially if they're called trying to convert someone to the Christian faith. There are countries in Africa. There are other countries in Asia, the Pacific Rim, the Caribbean or Caribbean, where Christians suffer persecution and execution. In our own lives, there's probably none of us here that have ever been physically harmed for being a Christian. But I'm sure some of us have experienced some verbal oppression and persecution. Or you were denied fellowship with a group or entrance in a group because people found out you were a practicing Christian. Or you lost friends because you stood up for something that you knew was right according to the Christian faith, and they just stood there and remained silent. And so, not only did the wife of Pilate suffer pain and evil, but the church and the individual Christians have suffered pain and evil ever since Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection and the beginning of the first church, that first Pentecost, in approximately 33 AD. And so, Pilate's wife's words were prophetic in that they not only dealt with the immediate situation, they dealt with what would be the history of the church. They dealt with what would be the common experience of the Christian faith as it continues to march throughout the world, proclaiming the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So as a dream sent by God, or just sent by Satan, I think that evidence shows clearly that it was sent by God so that the wife of the pilot's words would not only be a warning to her husband, but would be prophetic for the church. So this is why, especially in Eastern Christianity, she is considered to be a servant of the cross and a witness to our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit keep you in his light and truth and love, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with Lord Jesus, Think on Me, hymn number 599 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 599.
Our Wednesday evening service. Sunday services are at 8 and 10:30 p.m. or a.m. Next Wednesday, again at 2 and 7 p.m., we will have Lenten service. On Easter Sunday, we will have the 8 o'clock service, and at 9:15, what would be our Sunday school hour, we will be having a Easter breakfast. Everyone is welcome. And then the 10:30 service following that. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Again, thank you for watching us on YouTube.